In August 1969, just 50 years ago, Prunceaus O'Conlon paid a return visit to Tyrone in the radio series Hometown. This was incidentally recorded at the very beginnings of the Troubles and transmitted within days of Jack Lynch's We Shall Not Stand Idly By broadcast.
In the county Tyrone, near the town of Dungannon, where many's a ruction myself had a hand in, Bob Williamson lived a weaver by trade, and as all of us thought him a stout orange blade. On the 12th of July, as it yearly did come, Bob played on the flute till the sound of the drum. You may talk of piano or fiddle or lute, but there's nothing could sound like the old orange flute.
The dilemma of Bob Williamson and his flute is hardly the dilemma of the whole north of Ireland, but the sectarian dichotomy which gave rise to his problems most certainly is. In the county Tyrone, near the town of Dungannon, the ructions we all had a hand in were, as likely as not, religious ructions, the ructions of Protestant and Catholic, of orange and green. It was so in my days there. It is no less so, unfortunately, today. And just why Dungannon is as it is, divided and disrupted, is the question I always ask when I go back there. In those parts, one learned early to live with a divided society. And here I may as well make it plain that, as far as I was concerned, near the town of Dungannon meant 5 or 6 miles away. Ben Burb, though no less historic than Dungannon, can hardly claim to be a town. And it had not in my time, nor has it yet, a Catholic school. In my school days there, we Catholics from the Dungannon side of Ben Burb first felt the effects of our position when we had to walk about 3 miles to school in Blackwater Town, which is on the other side of the Blackwater River in County Armagh. On our way, we'd meet some of the Protestant children going to school in Ben Burb. That's where the ructions began for many of us.
This programme is very much influenced by the mood of that time, the summer of 1969.
Well, in my young day, we used to go to school and we used to meet the Protestants, they were going the opposite way to the high school. So one day one of them tackled me and he says, as he, if you don't cuss the Pope, he says, as he'll beat you up. Well, says, I just have a go at it. So he made me do it anyway. I tried to make me do it and I wouldn't do it. And so finish up, I had him a good punch in them, an undercut, if you like to put it that way. And I flattened him. And from that day on, I never had much bar with them. There was no home rule, the Fenian King and the Protestant Pope were Ulster no more after that. So a peace ever after.
In these sectarian encounters, it's not to be assumed that our side was always blameless and acted only in self-defence. However, looking back now, incidents like that seem to symbolise the struggle our people in particular had to face. Relations between neighbours, between them and us, were good. But when it came to a crunch, we knew who was the boss. They were. They were the people in the places of power. They had the last word on the things that really mattered, on education, housing, employment, the whole political and economic life of the town and district. And they, unfortunately, in their public manifestations as Urban District Council, Education Committee or whatever it was, were representative neither of the majority of the people of Dungannon nor of any kind of liberal ethic. Even today, our Unionist MP at Stormont, who also happens to be vested with authority as Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister for Home Affairs, can pride himself on his illiberal and narrow-minded attitudes. In the local council, the bigot and the backwoodsman still hold sway. And so the ancient divisions are perpetuated, divisions which are sharper possibly here than anywhere else in the north, because the sectarian balance is almost exactly 50-50.
And Prunceaus O'Conlon spoke to local historians.
How did these divisions come about? The answer brings us back, as the historian W.R. Hutchison reminds us, to the plantation of Ulster.
Yes, insofar as there was a Dungannon at all before the plantation. As a planned town, it really dates from then. I mean, before that, there wasn't a single planned town in Tyrone of any description. It was planned by Chichester, who got the district, and
the ubiquitous Chichester, as you might say.
Exactly, yes. Belfast Chichester, and all over the place Chichester. 144 townlands altogether. Of course, he left after about a century. At least his descendants left after that time. And then fell into the hands of the Knox family, who became the local landlords. And they certainly came from Scotland originally, via Belfast, where the first Thomas Knox was a sovereign of the city of Belfast. He bought this estate here from Chichester's descendant, Lord Donegal, in 1692, and owned most of the land round about here, including the town itself, of course.
I suppose Dungannon has to be influenced by the original settlers. I suppose you can see that in the town to this day.
Oh, I suppose you can, yes.
Scotch Street, for example, was that in fact a settlement of Scots people?
It was. It was assigned to the Scots, as Church Street was to the English, Irish Street to the Irish. And one must say that at the beginning, anyhow, they all seemed to have lived in perfect harmony with each other. There's no record of any great disturbance until the bad times round about the time of the English Civil War, 1641 and that. This place suffered like the rest during those wars.
The town of the Knoxes, the planters, the Scots and English, but equally the town of the O'Neills and the Old Irish. The field of scholarship, at least, is one where sectarianism finds no place. But if Dungannon, like Noah's Ark, must have two of everything, where better to have this duality than in the sphere of learning? And it has at least one other well-known historian, Father Eamon Devlin, author of Donoughmore, A Parish History.
The chief effect of the plantation was that the old Gaelic system came to an end, and that there was introduced in 1609 and 10 a new system of English feudal tenure, whereby the vast majority of the old Irish were dispossessed. But in that original plantation of 1609 and 10, quite a number of the old native stock got small proportions of land, a ballybow or two of land. They got it with the proviso, however, that they would forfeit these lands if they entered into rebellion. This they did in 1641. Because most of the old Irish who received grants that led, the extraordinary thing about it is that the old Irish who received grants of land in 1609 and 10, they were supposed to be hostile to Hugh O'Neill at the end of the period of the 9 Years' War. But their sons in 1641 were the very people who entered into rebellion, and they were the chief leaders of the rebellion in this district. Yeah. The war, the revolt of 1641, very nearly succeeded from the old Irish point of view. There were some great victories, but some tragic losses too. And with the final collapse of the Confederate armies in the middle of the 17th century, we had a new plantation, the plantation of Cromwell. All those old Irish who got small proportions of land, 1609 and 10, now forfeited them with very rare exceptions. These rare exceptions were also to suffer forfeiture at the end of the century at the time of the William Egg Plantation. In other words, there were three great plantations during the 17th century whereby all the old stock were completely dispossessed of their land.
Well, what have we left now to show us that the O'Neills once were lords of Dungannon?
Well, I would say the chief thing that we have left today is the old native stock, because notwithstanding the plantation of 1609 and notwithstanding the transportation that was carried out after the collapse of the Confederate armies in the time of Cromwell, notwithstanding all the confiscations and persecutions of the 17th century, they were not successful in rooting out the native stock. They held on to the bogs on the hillsides, and their descendants are with us today. And this is most clearly illustrated, I would say, in the whole matter of the surnames. Because you have the O'Neills themselves, and you have the O'Hagans and the O'Quins and the O'Donnellys and all the other families whose names can be traced back through the sources of Irish history, who were always the chief supporters of O'Neill in his campaigns.
So that, in a way, the troubles we have in the present day, the divisions and all the rest of it, are just a continuation, as it were, of
just
these wars of the 17th century.
Just a continuation. We hear a lot of talk today, for example, about discrimination. It's not a new thing at all. It has been going on. Somebody said in a speech the other day that there has been discrimination for the past 50 years. That was a complete understatement, because there has been discrimination from the very first days of the plantation right up to now. In the 17th century, we had the confiscations on the plantations. In the 18th century, in the early 19th century, we had the activities of very hostile landlords, I mean hostile to the native stock. And it was especially during the 18th century that the original planter stock blossomed out and became very numerous, which has given us this dichotomous division between planter stock and the old native stock to the present time.